13, verses 1 through 3. Praise the Lord. Praise your servants of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord from this time forth and forevermore. From the rising of the sun to its setting, the name of the Lord is to be praised. Let's worship.
You may be seated. Good morning. Welcome all of you to the Sunday morning worship gathering of Olivet Baptist Church. If you're a guest with us this morning, whether maybe it's your first time, second time, whatever it may be, we are so delighted. And I'm not just embellishing on that. We are delighted to have you here with us worshiping together. In many ways, we kind of consider this the family meal, and it's an opportunity for us to feast on God's Word together. And what a joy it is to be hospitable and to welcome in you to come and feast on the Word with us this morning. And so that's our prayer, that you would be edified and encouraged as you walk out of here. So some new faces here I see. I can't wait to get down into the pews and see how people are, and some faces that have come from a long way. You know who you are. Welcome, all of you, this morning. As we continue our worship gathering, if you are a guest, let me just say this. We'd love to connect with you. We'd love to pray for you specifically. You'll see a little connect card on the pew in front of you. We would invite you to take some time, fill that out. If you haven't already, if you visited last week or whatever it may be, fill that out. If there's a way that our elders can pray for you, put that on the back and then put that in the offering box as you make your way out of here. Our elders will be meeting this Wednesday night, and so you will get hot off the press prayers from us for you, and we would love to do that for you. Let's pray together as we continue to worship the Lord with our voices this morning. Father, as we continue this time of corporate worship, where we have set aside time to gather as your people, to exalt you, to exalt your name, and to exalt in you, to glory in your holy name. Lord, I pray that whatever has happened this week, Lord, maybe whatever has even happened this weekend, Lord, that you would not necessarily cause those things to fade away, but I pray that they, this morning, as we gather now, that they would pale in attention and comparison to what we have gathered to do this morning. That our worship of you, our delighting in you, our feasting upon your word, our singing and encouraging ourselves and one another with truths about you, that all of this worship this morning would just overshadow what we've experienced this week. And maybe if we've experienced joys this week, Lord, that this morning would just be a wonderful opportunity for us with the saints, with our fellow brothers and sisters, just to worship you with gratitude and thankfulness in our hearts to Christ Jesus this morning, that we would sing with all of our lungs, with all of our heart, about your goodness and your glory. But Lord, if this week has been filled with discouragement, with pain, with heartache, with longing, I pray, Lord, that as we feast upon your word, as we seek to treasure you and look to you as our only hope in life and death, that you would fill that void, that you would replenish our souls this morning, that you would help us to see and to treasure Jesus. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. Let's stand and sing about our Savior Jesus.
The Sing with me, how great is our God.
Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art, then save my soul, my Savior God, to to take me.
Well, as we do every year, as we step into the months of November and December, as a Southern Baptist church, we celebrate and we kind of emphasize the Lottie Moon Christmas offering. So if you've never heard of what that is, basically the Lottie Moon Christmas offering is a special offering that Southern Baptists all over the nation take up, usually around the Christmas season, obviously Lottie Moon Christmas offering, where 100% of what we give, 100%, goes to support our missionaries, some 3,500 plus missionaries all over the globe. You think about Chad and Deanna, Kyle and Kathy, who are ours, who are with the IMB. What we give and what other Southern Baptists like us give all over the nation, small churches, big churches, it goes to mainly the Lottie Moon. It supports pretty much all of their salary, puts them there, gets them there, okay? And so it is a big, big deal. So every year, we emphasize this in November and December. This is one of those things I've had people down through the years ask me, you know, above and beyond kind of what me and my family give, if we tithe or whatever percentage we give, kind of just first fruits kind of thing. What would you recommend if we want to give above and beyond? Like if we run into some extra money, God's blessed us, or we want to, you know, just keep being sacrificial and generous in our giving, what are some things that we could give above and beyond, beyond the local church? This would be great. This would be a great opportunity to give to the Lottie Moon Christmas offering. So if you want to give to that, if you're doing cash, take one of those blue envelopes in front of you, just write Lottie Moon on there, put it in the offering box. If you're doing, I don't know if we have an online option for that, but if you're doing check, just somewhere, make it very clear that that goes to Lottie Moon. And so we will be emphasizing this offering, showing you videos each week, kind of putting our hearts and minds further and further, just wrapping it around the globe and praying for our missionaries. And so Sean's going to lead us this morning, just praying for all of our IMB missionaries and for the offering this year.
Yep. Let's pray this morning. Heavenly Father, we look forward to this Lottie Moon Christmas offering, Lord, another way that we can contribute, Lord, to the work that's going on around the world. Lord, we realize, even just from watching this video, that there are multitudes of people who are, Lord, just loving their families, working jobs to pay for food, to go about their lives, Lord, seeking significance in something, and but Father, not knowing you. And Lord, in that way, it's kind of just existing. And so Lord, we our hearts go out to them, we intercede on their behalf, Lord. This is a tangible way that we can give towards an effort, Lord, to support missionaries who are going. We send from our church here, and some go. And so, Lord, we pray for those missionaries who are on the field now, those who will be on the field soon. We pray that the effort that they put forth, Lord, you would take and multiply in spreading the gospel among the nations, that your name would be glorified, that many, many would come to know you. And thank you for this part that we're able to play in that. And we pray all these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Well, I invite you to take your Bible and open with me to Matthew chapter 9. Matthew chapter 9, and we're getting near to the end of Matthew chapter 9 as we've been walking through the Gospel of Matthew for almost a year now. And so I will be about retirement age, it looks like, when we finish. I am getting more gray and gray in my hair, and the beard's starting to show it as well, so we truck on through Matthew chapter 9. We're in Matthew 9 this morning, and we're going to be looking at verses 27 through 34. Matthew 9, 27 through 34. And out of reverence for God's word, let's stand together for the reading. Hear the words of our Almighty God. And as Jesus passed on from there, two blind men followed him, crying aloud, "Have mercy on us, Son of David!" When he entered the house, the blind men came to him, and Jesus said to them, "Do you believe that I'm able to do this?" They said to him, "Yes, Lord." Then he touched their eyes, saying, "According to your faith, be it done to you." And their eyes were opened, and Jesus sternly warned them, "See that no one knows about it." But they went away and spread his fame through all that district. And as they were going away, behold, a demon-oppressed man who was mute was brought to him. And when the demon had been cast out, the mute man spoke, and the crowds marveled, saying, "Never was anything like this seen in Israel." But the Pharisees said, "He casts out demons by the prince of demons." Let's pray together. Lord, your word says, "Blessed are those whose way is blameless, who walk in the law of the Lord." And so this morning, Father, I pray that as we come to your word, Lord, I pray that you would give us a desire, Lord, that the overriding desire of our heart this morning would be to know you, to know your word, and to walk in your word. And I pray that your spirit would help me and help all of us as we receive your word this morning, so that we might receive it in faith, so that our eyes might be opened by you to treasure Jesus, to treasure your truth, and to walk in your ways. And I ask all of this in the powerful name of Jesus Christ. Amen. You may be seated. Well, as we near the end of Matthew chapter 9, one of the things that you may have noticed if you've been with us any length of time, or maybe you're familiar with the Gospel of Matthew and maybe this section of Scripture, one of the things that maybe you have noticed is that here lately, ever since Jesus finished the greatest sermon ever in Matthew 5 through 7, the Sermon on the Mount, ever since Matthew chapter 8 and into chapter 9, Jesus has been on an absolute healing spree. Starting all the way back in Matthew chapter 8, and depending on how small your font is, maybe it's on the same page or you can just reflect back one page. Starting all the way back in Matthew chapter 8, Jesus has just been on a healing spree. He healed a leper, a paralytic, a sick mother-in-law, two demon-possessed men, and the list goes on and on. And today, in our passage this morning, which makes for the ninth healing story in this section, we're going to see Jesus interact with some blind men. And I don't know if you saw it or not when I was reading through the passage, but Matthew's actually going to introduce us to two types of blind men. Matthew's got a little irony in store for us this morning, so I hope you are awake. Because first of all, we have some men who are physically blind. And then in the latter part of our passage, we have some men who are spiritually blind. And in verses 27 through 31, we are first introduced to the physically blind. Look at verse 27 with me. It says, "And as Jesus passed on from there, two blind men followed him, crying aloud." And if you look at the Greek there, this crying aloud, this isn't just a, hey, Jesus. You know, the crowds are around, hey, over here. This is, and I'd probably hurt some of your ears, wake up some of your babies, wake up some of you who are sleeping, and I would hate to do that if I really read with the Greek emphasis here. They were screaming this. "Have mercy on us, Son of David." Now, as we have done, and as I have made sure that we did in past weeks, I want to make sure that you and I, that we together this morning, reading this passage in this narrative, where we can so quickly zoom through certain details, especially the smaller ones, I do not want to let you do that this morning. Before we just zoom on through this text, I want you to stop. And I want you, for even just a millisecond, to try to imagine, as hard as it may be, and for some of you, it's not all that hard because you have really bad eyesight. But I want you to try and to imagine with me, to try to kind of take the nebulous kind of abstractness of this kind of story, and to really make it personal, I want you to try and to imagine with me just for a moment what it would be like to be blind. And some of you, you're doing what you ought to do. You're doing this. You're closing your eyes. Because I'm not saying try to imagine with me you having really, really bad eyesight, because we kind of laughingly say some of you, like, that's just true of your everyday living. You're blind as a bat. I'm saying try to imagine total blindness. No light, no shapes, no color, nothing. This past weekend, many of you know, my dad and I and a big group of hunters from our home church in Farmersville, they came up through Wichita, picked me up, and we went up northwest of Salina to do some pheasant hunting and golfing, and it was a wonderful escapade, just a great time with my dad. And while we were up there, 18 of us from Texas, including me, 18 of us, big group, and while we pull into Downs, Kansas, the thriving metropolis of Downs, Kansas. We pull into Downs, Kansas. We pull into our lodge, a bunch of white Chevy Silverados, you know, with dog boxes in the back. And we all file out rank and number. And you can just tell. I mean, if you were there sitting on the deck watching us drive up, we get out of the trucks and all of us, we're almost like little boys. We're just giddy with excitement about the weekend and the hunting we're going to do and just the camaraderie, the golf, the campfire, the playing 42 while we're watching the World Series and the Cowboy game Sunday night. Sorry if you're not a Cowboy fan. These are all Texas guys. And if you didn't know, your pastor is a closet Cowboy fan. But, I mean, we were giddy with excitement as we got out of the trucks and as we started in Friday evening. We get there Friday evening, and, man, we're just pumped. But something I noticed, and I noticed this last year, because the outfit that we hunt with, man, they are just booked up. And so if you keep your spot, you'll end up seeing the same people every year. And there was another house beside our lodge, and there was another group of, I think, some doctors from Nebraska and Arizona. Anyway, I remember one guy kind of looked like Father Christmas, and I saw him again this year. And so we started to say hello to these guys, and as we're all filing into the eating area for dinner together, you know, our group is just, like I said, giddy with excitement. But I noticed something as this group, about seven or eight guys, started filing in to get in line for dinner. I noticed a very different mood among these men. I noticed that their mood was one that was quiet, somber, serious. And pretty soon I found out why. Because while our group, was merrily making our way up to Downs, Kansas, excited for the trip, Friday morning while they were out on their morning hunt, one of the men in their group, a 78-year-old man, was flanking out to the side. And a bird went up, a shot was fired, and an errant BB flew into this guy's eye. He was not wearing protective glasses. Lodged in the back of one of his eye bones. He was emergency rushed to Wichita, and he ended up losing complete eyesight in that eye. And I'll be honest, when I heard that, because confession, I've hunted a lot in my life, and I never once have worn protective glasses. And so while I'm sitting there eating my dinner, it may not have shown on my face, but it shook me. Because I stopped in my tracks, and in fact, I kind of just put my fork down and got sick at my stomach for a while because I tried to reflect and tried to do what I just asked you to do and to truly consider my life blind. At 35, and the rest of my life living in that condition. And I just reflected there at that table with a group of men, in the solace of my own soul and mind, I reflected upon the blessing that is my eyesight. The fact that I can see. That I can see the majesty of that Saturday morning sunrise as we're getting out into the field and loading our guns. That I can see the intricate beauty of that pheasant that God created. I mean, if you've ever looked at a pheasant, a beautiful bird, that I can see the intricate beauty of that bird as it takes flight. That I can see at night the splendor of the stars and the glow of the campfire. I can see. But these men, they couldn't see anything. They were blind. And so in their desperation, you've got to remember how viral and popular Jesus was at this moment. In their desperation, guess what they do? They track down the one guy that they've heard all these stories about. I said to you, this is the, how many healing stories have we had prior to this? That Matthew has recorded. No telling how many more healings. I mean, we have certain sections like Matthew 8, 16, that evening they brought to him many who were oppressed by demons, and he cast out the spirits with a word and healed all who were sick. So you had all these stories floating around this entire region, and these men, in their total darkness, total blindness, in their desperation, they tracked down the one man they've heard all this hubbub about, and they didn't just follow him around the city streets. If you read closely, these guys were persistent. They followed him, it says, into the house. And that's interesting to me that Jesus is walking in the streets. He could have stopped out in the streets and dealt with these men, but he goes into the house. These men, who knows if they knew the owner of the house or whatever, they started to shut the door. Nope, we're coming in. And they said to Jesus, probably in a calmer tone than what they were yelling out in the streets, "Son of David, have mercy on us." Now let's talk about this title for a second. Let's talk about this title, because when you hear this title, Son of David, if you've been tracking with us through the Gospel of Matthew, immediately your mind is taken all the way back to Matthew 1:1. The book of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. And here in Matthew chapter 9, verse 27, this is the first time that we hear someone refer to Jesus with this title, the son of David, except for Matthew in chapter 1. And while it may not seem like much of a big deal that they would use this kind of title, them calling Jesus the son of David was a massive deal. This wasn't just a title that highlighted his family tree. Oh, he comes from David and ultimately the line of Judah, and that's where we can kind of ancestry.com place him. This was a title that was pregnant with messianic meaning. It was all over this title. You see, a thousand years ago, before Jesus encountered these two blind men and they blurt out this title, 1,000 years before this, God spoke to King David through the prophet Nathan, and he said this in 2 Samuel 7. Listen. He said to David, "When your days are fulfilled and you lie down with your fathers, I will rise up your offspring after you." Okay, all right, Solomon, I'm with you. "Who shall come from your body," all right, Solomon, "and I will establish his kingdom," Solomon, 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 Solomon. "He shall build a house for my name," Solomon, "and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever." Not Solomon. So when these two blind men yelled out to Jesus, "Son of David, have mercy on us," again, they were not just highlighting his family tree. They were highlighting his messiahship. These completely, physically blind men were, in a sense, saying to Jesus, "We know exactly who you are. You are the Messiah. You're the eternal King that God said was coming. You are the Son of God. You are the Son of David. You see, there is absolutely no question. These men, again, I emphasize, these ironically blind men, they knew exactly who Jesus was. Yes, they couldn't have told you how tall Jesus was. They couldn't have told you how hairy he was. They couldn't have told you the color of his eyes. They could have taken an educated guess and probably said brown and been right. But I tell you what, they could have told you who he was. He is the Son of David. And look at what it says in verse 28. When he entered the house, the blind men came to him, and Jesus said to them, "Do you believe that I'm able to do this?" And with the next response, I wish I was there, because to me, I feel like you almost get this feeling like, "Did you not hear what we just called you?" Yeah, yes, you're the Messiah. You're the eternal King. You're the Son of David. Sure. Then he touched their eyes. And don't blow past that either. I think it's a small thing in the text, but over and over again, through Matthew 8 and Matthew 9, we have seen Jesus violating all the cleanliness laws, touching lepers, touching paralytics, touching women with discharge of blood for 12 years, touching all sort of unclean people, the untouchables of the society. And Jesus once again reaches out, touches their eyes, and he says, "According to your faith," notice please the emphasis on faith in this passage, seeing and faith. He says, what does he say? What's the emphasis of his question? Do you believe that I'm able to do this? He doesn't say, "Is this going to impress you if I do this?" He says, "Do you believe?" And then when they say, "Yes, Lord," he says, "According to your faith, be it done to you." And their eyes were opened. Get your imagination flowing again. I said, imagine you're blind. And now I want you to imagine this. This millisecond, this moment. This could have very well been the first time that these two men saw anything. How many things did you take for granted this morning that you were able to see? It's untold. It's innumerable. This could have very well, likely, was the first time that these men saw anything, saw the light of day, saw the flight of a sparrow, saw the flicker of a candle, saw the face of another person, saw the look of their hands, and just imagine with me for a second. This means that likely, I mean, just put yourself in their shoes. You have been blind for potentially all of your life, and then the moment your eyes are open, the first thing you see with your opened eyes is the face of Jesus. It don't get any better than that. It does not get any better than that. And while this story is not given to us primarily as a metaphor or anything like that, if you're seeing what's going on in the passage, you do see that this story certainly serves as a metaphor for all of us before we came to Christ. Because before we came to Christ, all of us were born spiritually blind. We were blind to the things of God. We were blind. We could not see Jesus as he really was. Our sin had blinded us, the scripture says. And the only reason, brothers and sisters, the only reason that you and I see this morning is because God, in his marvelous grace, opened your eyes to see your sin, to see your Savior, and to run to him in faith, essentially crying out with the same thing these blind men said, "Have mercy on me. Open my eyes so that I may see you." But until that moment, you couldn't see. You say, "Well, I actually have pretty good spiritual eyesight." No, no, no. You would not have come to faith in Christ unless God, in his marvelous grace, first initiated that and opened your eyes so that, like these blind men, you were maybe not deer in headlights as a terror kind of thing, but just in awe and wonder. I see my sin, but more than my sin, and overshadowing my sin, I see my Savior. I see the Son of David, and I see him with crystal clarity, and I can't wait to savor and to walk with him the rest of my life. And the reality is, for many of us, we probably see the same kind of thing in the unbelieving friends and family members and neighbors that God has placed around us. We talk to them about the gospel. We try to talk to them about Jesus. We try to have spiritual conversations with them, and they just don't get it. They can't get it. And what the scripture is saying this morning, unless God opens their eyes, they won't get it. And all of that is why we pray what we pray. We pray the simple, humble prayers of the saints, trusting in Almighty God, saying, "Lord, essentially, have mercy on them. Lord, open their eyes. Open their eyes to see their sinfulness. Open their eyes to see Jesus in all of his splendor, in all of his majesty, and in this section, all of his power and perfection and authority. Lord, open their eyes." And brothers and sisters, if that is not already your prayer right now for those unbelieving friends and family members in your life, you make that your simple, humble prayer to the Son of David. "Jesus, open their eyes. Do what you did to these two blind men. Do what I cannot do. Do what I could not do for myself. Open their eyes." Well, upon causing these two blind men to see, verse 30 goes on to say, look there, it says, "And Jesus sternly warned them." I have to admit, I did filter this through a dad lens this morning, a parent lens. There are times where I warn my children, parents, and there are times where I sternly warn them. "Hey, go do this." Sternly warn them. "Look at me. Go do this." And in Jesus' terms, "Don't go do this." Notice what he says. Jesus sternly warned them, "See that no one knows about it." You gotta love these guys, though. Because just take a guess. You already know the answer, but for fun, take a guess. You're reading this the first time. Take a guess at what these guys did immediately after trusting in Jesus, seeing him in all of his glory, receiving their sight. What is the first thing that they did? Well, they received him in baptism. No, they did not. They disobeyed him. Instead of keeping their mouths shut like Jesus told them to, they became instant evangelists. Look at what verse 31 says. "But they went away and spread his fame through all that district." And friends, this is just what happens when Jesus opens people's eyes for the first time. Isn't it? Have you been around those newbies? We'll call them newbies. Those new to the faith. Can you remember back when you first came to faith in Christ, when Jesus first opened your eyes so that you could see with 20/20 vision him in all of his splendor and saving majesty? You can't help but just want to tell everybody. And your friends and your family members, and you know, they bore the brunt of that. But this kind of response, it shouldn't just characterize the newbies, should it? And that's what I'm struck by in this narrative, the responses of the people. The responses of the blind men, of the crowd, of the Pharisees. And this kind of awe and wonder and trust and just eager expectancy to get out there and to spread his fame, it should not just characterize the newbies among us. It should characterize us. Those of us who have had the privilege of seeing and knowing and loving and walking with Jesus for 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, some of you, 60 plus years. Because when you see Jesus as he truly is, you cannot help but spread his fame. So let me say something a little hard to hear. It's hard to hear for me, and it's hard probably to hear for many of us. I think what this unfortunately means is if you have an evangelism problem, you already know where I'm going. If you have an evangelism problem, the heart of the matter is you probably don't have an evangelism problem. You probably have a seeing and savoring Jesus problem. The issue is probably that you're not seeing him and savoring him and treasuring him like you're supposed to. And as I said, that is just as much of a spiritual gut punch for me as maybe it is to you. And before I just go on from here into the next group of blind men, let's stop and let's just relish and meditate on and reflect on what we have seen over these past two chapters, that our Savior is not just a powerful and authoritative Savior, he is a compassionate and gracious Savior. And that's the beauty of the gospel. Because even in our moments where we realize maybe what just clicked for you this morning, what clicked for me, you don't have an evangelism problem. You have a problem of seeing and savoring Jesus like you're supposed to. That's your issue. And instead of us doing the natural, fleshly thing of, oh, I'm a terrible person, and just shame and guilt and heaping, and I'm just going to distance myself from him, that is the worst thing you could possibly do. And that shows you don't really see him as he really is. Because think of the just explosive, infinite amount of grace and mercy and compassion that we have seen from the heart of Christ even in just these two chapters. Our Savior is a merciful Savior, and when things like that click in our life and we see I'm not where I'm supposed to be or should be these 20 years, these 30 years, these 4 years, I should be way farther along in my seeing and savoring of Jesus. Maybe that is true. It is true for all of us. But what is also true is that's why you have such a compassionate and loving Savior. And the beautiful thing about Jesus is he is always ready to supply you with the grace, with the passion, with the desire to see and to savor him. I think the bottom line is, how often do we do what these two blind men did? And in those moments, rather than run, rather than just get deeper into our Bible reading plan, and rather than just to say, Lord, have mercy. Help me to see you, and help me to savor. I can't conjure this up on my own. Do it within me as I seek to know you more and more. We've looked at these physically blind men. Some of you probably cheated and you say, I didn't see any spiritually blind men in here. It's kind of a Where's Waldo thing. They're hidden right at the end. We've seen the physically blind men. Now I want us to turn our attention to the spiritually blind men. And we find them in verses 32 and 34. Verse 32 says, "As they were going away, behold, the demon-oppressed man who was mute was brought to him. And when the demon had been cast out, the mute man spoke. And the crowds marveled, saying, 'Never was anything like this seen in Israel.'" It's kind of interesting to me when you look at the three different responses in this passage. It's like the first response of the blind man is a ding, 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 ding. They see him. Then you've got the crowds that it's kind of like, you see him, but I don't think you see him. But you see something about him. You're on to something. You're, as in Jesus would say, you're not far from the kingdom of God. But notice what verse 34 says. "But the Pharisees said, 'He casts out demons by the prince of demons.'" The Pharisees were those who could see and yet couldn't see. They could see all the kinds of miraculous works that Jesus was doing. You read through all four Gospels, and when all this stuff is happening, they never once deny that Jesus was doing mind-blowing things. They could see, but they couldn't see. They couldn't see the truth, that Jesus was doing all of these things, not because he was the prince of the demons, but because he was the Son of David, the very Son of God. But they just couldn't see it. Why? Back to our theme. They were blind. So in our passage today, you have blind men and you have blind men. But the main question this morning isn't about either of them. The main question this morning is actually about you. The main question is not, well, do they see him? Do they see it? Does he see it? Does she see it? The main question this morning as we walk away from this text is, do you see it? Do you see Jesus as he really is? Not as who you think he might be, but as he really is. Do you have the eyes to see and to savor Jesus? And if you do, then the application here this morning is not intricate and hard. If you do have the eyes to see and to savor Jesus, if you do have the eyes to trust him and to treasure him above all things, then your response this morning ought to be just to praise him and to thank him for opening your eyes, because what has happened to you isn't something that happened naturally. It's something that happened supernaturally. And if you're here this morning and you can't see, and maybe you don't even see that you don't see, but maybe the Lord has given you enough, the Holy Spirit has given you enough wherewithal to see, no, I don't think I see Jesus in all of his splendor and all of his glory. And if that's you this morning, if you've never seen Jesus for all that he is and trusted in him with all of your heart, then the response for you this morning is like these two blind men, just to cry out in simple faith and say to the Lord Jesus Christ, "Have mercy on me. Help me to see my sin. Help me to see you, Lord Jesus, and help me to walk with you." Olivet, as we close out this year, and especially with Advent coming our way quickly, just bought a Christmas tree yesterday. It's already here. As we close out this year, I want to challenge you, I want to invite you, I want to warmly encourage you. Let us make this our prayer for one another. that Jesus would give us the eyes to see him and to savor him more deeply this year and this close to the year than we ever have before. Let's make that our prayer this morning, all right? Let's pray together and for one another. Lord Jesus, as we conclude our study of this wonderful passage, we thank you. We thank you by your grace and by your mercy, Lord, that you have given us eyes to see you. Lord, we need to see so much more of you. Our eyes are still blinded by our daily sins, but Lord, we have eyes to see. We have the Spirit of God within us to see our sin and to see you in all of your splendor and all of your majesty, and just to love you, to know you, and to grow deeper in our relationship with you, walking with you. And so we praise you and we thank you for that grace, because we realize, as one people with one heart and one mind, we realize what the Scripture makes very, very clear, that our coming to see you and to know you is not something we did. It's something that you did through the gospel of your Son. And we thank you for that. I pray for those who were here this morning, Lord, who, when they came this morning, whether they thought it or not, they could not see Jesus as he really is. I pray this morning that through the power of your word, by the power of the Spirit, that the lights would come on, that the eyes would be opened, and that they would love and treasure Jesus Christ for the first time this morning, that they would truly see. And I pray that our church family would help them to see you better, to know you deeper, and to follow you harder. I pray for all of us. I pray for my faith family, Olivet Baptist Church. And I pray that as we finish out this year, as we look to Advent to just celebrate the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, I pray, Lord God, that you and all of your sovereign power would do what we cannot do, that you would help us to see and to savor Jesus more deeply than we ever have before. And we ask it all in Christ's name. Amen. Let's stand together and let's sing a very fitting song to our passage. I want to actually invite you to be seated, not for long, but as we close things out, just want to remind you of a few things. Hopefully you got a bulletin, because I'm not going to mention all these things, or you're getting the email. We send out a weekly email every week. If you want to be on that, put that on the Connect card, put your email on there, we'll get you signed up. Just a reminder, we've got, as every week, we've got Wednesday night classes for everybody at 6:30. This Wednesday night, Awana for the kids. Ladies, I think it's this Friday night, you have the Women's Relate and Create that I think is down in the Carol Room, and you can read more about that. I don't think there's a sign up for that, so just show up. It's a great opportunity just to get to know other ladies in our church family. And then last thing I think I want to mention is Operation Christmas Child. Next Sunday, immediately following our Sunday morning worship gathering, you're invited to join us in the gym. We'll have tables set up and all the Operation Christmas Child stuff set up to fill the boxes. And so that's going to be happening next Sunday, right after our worship gathering. Kids, families, everybody, do it together. And in preparation for that, also, you will notice that we are kind of a host site for drop-off. So for other churches or people in the area who are going to be dropping off boxes, the week, I think starting maybe Sunday, next Sunday. You can see the schedule right here. We need volunteers to help come, and I think they're like 1 or 2 hour slots that you can just find a spot that works, show up, and receive boxes. And I think Diana Kearns' name and contact is on there if you have more questions about that. And so with the Operation Christmas Child thing, pay attention to this video before we head out.
Events and the greatest journey class.
able to make a strong foundation of empowering the new generation. They know the story of God, and they can tell others by using the books.
Every shoebox is really the beginning of the journey of evangelism and discipleship, and that leads into multiplication. And multiplication of lives, the multiplication of churches, really impact on communities, a ripple effect around the world. You begin the process as you pack a shoebox.
We divide your shoebox, and we thank you for the hand who packs the box.
We're part of the team, and we're partners in the gospel through Operation Business South and through Samaritan's Purse.
All right, so show up next week, pack a box. Something I might encourage you to do too. I think this is allowed. Bonnie, Mark, you may have to correct me on this. I think we want to do this to maybe give you some time too. If you already kind of know who you're going to pack a box for, what age and all that, I think you're encouraged also. You can write a note, personal note. Is that accurate? They don't take those out, do they? That'd be kind. Well, to write a personal note, you got a whole week. Maybe with you, families, this would be a very intentional thing you could do with your kids to write, you know, pick an age group ahead of time and write a personal note, maybe where you could share some spiritual truth in there, in the letter. I think we'll have opportunities to do it day of, but we're giving you a week's notice, so be aware of that. I invite you to stand. Let me give you the benediction from God's word, and Olivet, as you get out of here, before you get out of here, I want to remind you of this. It's still football season to do that two-minute drill. And if you see somebody around you that you don't know or you say, yeah, I'm pretty sure they're new, you take the initiative, not to be weird, but you take the initiative to welcome them warmly in the name of Christ and just get to know them. And so as you head out into this week, may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. You're dismissed.